2016, resolution number 2013-R47 to reverse the decision of the Commission of Architectural Review, which denied a certificate of appropriateness for bottom replacement vendors on a home located at 2916 Monument Avenue. Can we have an introduction to the paper?
This is a paper I put in because it's the only way for the person who is aggrieved by our decision to have a set in the other public forum of the close of the stepping stone between here and the circuit court. It's an issue where the gentleman had windows that were in very bad shape. One contractor suggested it would cost over $47,000, $50,000, in order to try to fix them, that it would be plywood in the windows for 120 days, leaking weeks. It seems like a significant hardship. More importantly, the windows that were chosen have been placed in several other buildings in this old historic district, some non-contributing, some not going through the CAR process. The code is pretty clear that CAR shall issue certificates of appropriateness for alterations that are compatible with the property and the old historic district, which it's part of. The significance of the property is a case-by-case basis. The historical significance of the old historic district in which the property resides is the primary consideration, but not the only consideration. CAR has to rely on the guidelines they have adopted. It's a 122-page manual. Those guidelines, however, are only advisory and not mandatory to be followed. In those guidelines, vinyl is not disallowed. It is strongly discouraged. These are vinyl windows we're talking about. That's on page 90 of the guidelines. In this case, it's my belief, as the council person for that property, it is two blocks away from the first district, but it is technically in the second, that the architectural character is not altered here in any substantial way. There's no radical changes to the sash depth of the reveal, the monthly configuration, reflective qualities, the color of the basing, the appearance of the frame in general. That's important. To CAR, that's on page 59, number 8, in the Old Historic District Manual. And I think really when you look at what it would have taken to possibly be able to repair them, I just don't think it's reasonable to ask a gentleman to do that, or a family to do that. I think CAR's main concern is that there's going to be a influx of these types of applications. I never like to provide forgiveness where there hasn't been permission asked, but I think this is a special situation. I think that's why we don't see a whole lot of appeals from CAR, because they work hard, and I appreciate the work that they do. However, we have to decide whether or not they acted in error or not. In this case, I believe they did, asking the committee to recommend approval of this paper to the full council.
Thank you, Mr. Samuels. Are there any questions? I'd like to go ahead and open it up for public comment in favor. Item number 13.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair. Welcome. Members of council, members of the committee. To be on the side of the microphone, I don't know if you do the, you have 30 seconds, please give a summarize on this. So maybe my name is Bill Pantele. I represent Mr. Tom Houghton, who resides at 2916 Monument Avenue. Mr. Houghton is an environmental engineer, travels about 90% of the time out of the city. He's not a member of MAPS. He's traveling and working all the time. He has a wife with a disability who lives at home. He had a fire at this residence a number of years ago, where the fire department criticized the existing windows, saying something had to be done with them. They were very poor condition. And threatened, the battalion commander at that time threatened to knock them all out. And so Mr. Howard had windows on his mind for some time, but he was unavailable. He could not afford to do anything but the windows at that time, about 10 years ago. But he managed to pile up a little cash and started moving forward. But first, he did bring in contractors, as Mr. Samuel said, to evaluate the windows. And that written evaluation, which I had, states that before any work was done, and some work, after some of the work was done, this is what they look like. So I know it's not fair to look at it from this far away, but they're very close. Now, in all else, Mr. Cobb did not know and did not apply for the certificate of appropriateness that's required. It came as some surprise to him. This is kind of an ongoing problem with respect to windows in the historic districts of the city. It has been for years, because you don't need generally to apply for a building permit for a window replacement because it's not structural. But in an old historic district, you do. That presumes the person knows. And we know that a lot of folks simply don't. This is a photograph just to show you that this particular window that he picked is very common up and down Lightning Avenue and all the historic districts. This is a photograph of property next door. Beautiful windows. Every single one of them is a vinyl window of the exact same model that this man picked. This neighbor also did not apply for a certificate of appropriateness. In August of last summer, which is about the time this work commenced at Mr. Howden's house, C.A.R. approved this window, the 405 North Boulevard, right around the corner. It is the exact same window that Mr. Howden proposes. I could go on. I will simply represent to you that there are probably 4, 5, 6 other buildings within a block of Mr. Howden's house, all of which have the same model of window. Some have been approved by CAR, some there's been no application. You're familiar perhaps with the Stewart Circle Apartments at Lombardi and Monument? Northwest corner.
Your time is up.
It's yours. Stewart Circle Apartments, old building on Monument Avenue, historic Monument Avenue, window 14,000, vinyl window. So Mr. Howden once advised that he did, in fact, need to make this application, did make his application, and proceeded to the Commission for Architectural Review. And we're here because of the decision of CAR that afternoon where his certificate was rejected. And of course, in making our presentation there, we pointed out all these other properties in the old historic district that carry that have either been approved, these windows exist in many places. In addition, I was reading some of these off. This is a partial list from the window manufacturer, window work, which is just one manufacturer. 1000 West Franklin Street, 209 West Franklin Street, 11 West B Street, 3200 Monument Avenue, 2335 West Grace, 1832 West Grace, 312 North Monroe Street, 1113 West Grace Street. The manufacturer has told me that there are thousands of these windows in all of this store. CAR, considering this case and ruling against Mr. Howden, really couldn't focus on the window, though I think some of the people who are interested in this are focused on the window. Instead, they focused on that he never should have removed the windows in the first instance. But I just think that I urge counsel that at some point, as important as these guidelines are, protect neighborhoods, and I support that. There has to be some reasonableness. And when the cost grows to that size, and what's being used in replacement is attractive, it doesn't take away from the neighborhood in any way or cause any kind of loss to the neighborhood in any way, then I think that doing the right thing by the citizens is to grant these approvals. I've mentioned to you how many properties are out there that never applied. People have bought houses whose windows already existed. And I suspect we're going to find there's a very large number of properties out there that we, that everyone be treated the same. Everybody be treated fairly. I know what will happen if we pursue all these other windows. They'll never have evidence to show that their windows were so far gone that they never should have been removed to begin with. And if the outcome of all of that is that the cities will start telling people to start pulling windows out to go get good windows, nice windows, efficient windows, to pull them out so we can put old wood back in. I think we're taking the protective elements of the old historic district too far. So I'm glad to answer any questions, and I appreciate your support in reversing this decision.
Thank you, Mr. Pantele.
My name is Phil Persinger. I'd like to speak in support of this paper. I'd also like to object to Mr. Pantele's special treatment, speaking longer than 3 minutes. I don't know if it's because he's a lawyer or a former councilman, but he was at a meeting.
You have time. More than welcome to take.
Okay, well, I don't need the time, but I want to encourage you to treat everyone equally. He was advocating for fair treatment, equal treatment for everyone. I think he should be extended the same privilege that I get, 3 minutes. Thank you for the opportunity. I support Mr. Sanders' paper. I think Mr. Pantele made some good points. And please move this paper forward with the committee's recommendation. Thank you.
Anyone to speak in favor of this paper? Does anyone speak against this paper?
Staff is following up with enforcement proceedings on a number of the properties mentioned by Mr. Pantele. answer questions you might have.
Any questions for the committee or council?
I wonder if Mr. Pantele alluded to the fact that that C.A.R. has in the past granted permission on the windows. Is that correct?
They have, yes. It's strongly discouraged and rarely permitted, but in certain instances, they review things on a case-by-case basis for the code. The property at 405 North Boulevard that he mentions, where they recently approved the vinyl window, that's not a historic building. It's like a 1960s, 1970s apartment building that's set significantly back from the sidewalk. Whereas Mr. Houghton's property is a historic building in Monument Avenue that's red against the sidewalk.
I have one more question. In the cases of now, you have people that are going to track down and say vinyl windows.
I'm sorry, couldn't you?
I said, I thought that we're going to start looking at people that have vinyl windows illegally.
Yes.
Are we going to make them take those windows out?
We received a complaint from a citizen, and the citizen has to remain anonymous, but they provided a list of properties within the city owned historic district that have vinyl windows. And so staff is required to follow up. So we're going to be citing property owners, and they're going to be going through the C.A.R. process.
And if C.A.R. turns them down,
if C.A.R. turns them down,
and they need to take their windows out and put in new windows.
They will need to propose to C.A.R. an alternative, yes, where they'll need to appeal to city council.
But not by law.
The commission reviews things on a case-by-case basis, so it depends on the
type of
window.
In the future, they could approve a vinyl windows on other structures.
They potentially could, depending on the quality and the appearance of the window.
Thanks.
Any other questions?
The stop work order is, of course, a violation has got to go to court. And as is installing windows, it's a misdemeanor. Do you know what class misdemeanor is?
I don't know. We don't normally take people to court.
This gentleman, you did?
Building and inspections, yes, sir. Because he did not have the required permit.
What evidence do we have, if any, that the windows that were removed and replaced were not deteriorated to the point that they needed to be replaced?
Most of the windows had been replaced before staff could get there. We recommended that property owner hold on to the existing historic windows, but they did not. So the remaining windows, there are two or three at the front of the property that are the same age as the original historic windows. And so those are the only remaining evidence about the condition of the existing windows in the property. And to my eye, they looked to be repairable.
Fair to say, they can only speak to their own condition, right?
I beg your pardon?
Is it fair to say those windows can only speak to their own condition?
That's fair to say. But the commission also considered the quality of the replacement product and they found it to be unacceptable for the line man and the owner storage.
Now, the next question. Do we have anything to suggest that the windows that were replaced weren't in the shape the contractor used to describe them?
We do not have. I wish they had come to the commission before they replaced them so that they could document the condition.
Yeah. And then as far as the inflated price, did anybody else do an estimate? Did C.A.R. go out with an estimate of what it would cost to repair or replace windows?
No,
the only evidence we have as to the shape of the windows is that contractor's letter.
And the remaining historic windows on the property, yes.
Which speak to themselves, but not to the other windows. I think it's very true not to interpretation. I might have two coffee mugs side by side. One has coffee and it doesn't speak to what the next coffee mug has inside. I have a ton of windows on the side of my house that are deteriorating a substantial bit more than windows 3 feet down based on where the water spout is on my gutters. To suggest that one window dictates how all the windows were is, well, I'm getting stuff. It's a fallacy to do that sophomore logic. The point is, we don't know what the windows look like. The only evidence we have is that letter from the contractor, which says they're basically beyond repair. How can we rise above the only evidence? Yeah, I'm sorry. I don't mean to ask that question. I take that question back. Thank you for the work, guys.
Any other questions?
My name is Jim Gates. I'm a member of the Commission of Architectural Review, a registered architect in the city that specializes in restoration of historic buildings, and I live on Monument Avenue. The original window signs were a critical element of the overall architectural character of historic structures. And there was a loss of historic fabric that diminishes the historic nature of the building and the district. The application that we were asked to review was to replace historic windows with vinyl windows. They were different material and configuration than the original windows. This replacement was not according to our guidelines and our handbook and review guidelines. And those are based on the Secretary of the Interior standards for rehabilitation of buildings that are developed by the National Park Service. Regarding specific instances and guidelines, I will just read you several of them on page 51, number 9. Do not remove or radically alter fundamental architectural features, such as windows, roofs, or porches. On page 59, number 5, original windows should be replaced by patching, splicing, consolidating, or otherwise reinforcing them. Number 15, do not replace multi-paned sash windows with new thermal sash windows that use false mountings, which is what these windows are. And on page 90, which has already been referenced, to vinyl replacement windows are strongly discouraged and really committed. The City Code, section 114-930.7, standards and guidelines state, the Commission of Architectural Review shall issue a certificate of appropriateness for the rehabilitation of a property that determines the proposed change is compatible with the property and with the old historic district of which it is a part. The historic design, features, materials, finishes, and craftsmanship of the property shall be preserved whenever possible. Significant historic features of the property shall be treated with care. The Commission may require that existing materials, decorative elements, and structural elements be repaired and replaced. The Commission may adopt additional rehabilitation standards for the review of certificates of appropriateness to supplement these standards. That's City Code. Each application is reviewed on its own merits. Some of the locations cited by the property owner and Mr. Pantele are in violation of C.A.R. guidelines because a certificate of appropriateness was never issued. I've practiced architecture in the city for 40 years. I have worked on numerous historic buildings. Rarely have I found that windows cannot be repaired unless the building was abandoned for a period of years or that it had been badly vandalized. I have restored windows in several of my own houses. And it's not often the easiest thing to do, but it can be done with relative ease. C.A.R. was responding to the complaint of a neighbor of 2016. C.A.R. was responsible only for a notice of violation, nothing more. The issuance of the stop work notice was generated by the Department of Building Inspection, and any further action was the result of the city, not C.A.R. Mr. Houghton cites correctly that the purview of C.A.R. is limited to what is visible from the public right-of-way. Since this house is located on a very prominent corner of Monument Avenue, three of the four elevations are visible from the public right-of-way. The use of inappropriate replacement windows works to damage and destroy the architectural integrity of the house cited by the city. Thank you very much. Do you have any questions?
Thank you.
Committee members, my name is Amy Swartz, Director of Preservation Services with Historic Richmond. I'm here to urge you to support the decision made recently at 2916 Monument Avenue by the Commission of Architectural Review. The applicant clearly went against the procedure on making an application to C.A.R. after the windows were replaced, as well as against the guidelines for materials. This is an obvious violation, and the applicant should be required to replace the windows with repaired originals or like materials of the originals. C.A.R. was established by City Council in 1957 and is the city's official historic preservation body charged with reviewing all exterior changes to structures within the city's building historic districts and issuing certificates of appropriateness for those projects that it deems appropriate. C.A.R. bases all its decisions generally on the Federal Secretary of the Interior Standards for Rehabilitation and New Construction, and specifically on Richmond Old and Historic District's Handbook and Design Review Guidelines. The guidelines were adopted in 1999. In 2010, C.A.R.'s purpose and procedures were reviewed by a City Council Task Force to reduce the number of appeals seen by council. I urge you today to validate the C.A.R. decision. Support city staff, our appointed commissions, and our residents who follow the law. Protect your historic buildings and districts. Do not invalidate the Commission of Architectural Review. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Honorable City Council people, my name is Mary Jane Ho. I'm the Executive Director of Historic Richmond. 2916 Monument Avenue is not complicated. It is a homeowner who did not go through the process, a process stipulated by law. City Council appoints their commissions, and we know that you trust your appointments. Our esteemed City Council, you had a dozen public meetings in 2009 and 2010. I was at most of them. Many of you were at them. The City Council went through this task force to create a process that was efficient, didn't waste council's time, that guidelines were clear, and windows did not come up at one of those, probably because people realized the Secretary of Interior standards dictates what windows should be. This is not about being against an individual. It is for a neighborhood. There are hundreds of residents that follow the rules every day. Please do not reward someone who did not follow the rules. And when it was pointed out to him, he chose to throw away the windows, even though he was told not to. We hope that you will trust the neighborhood associations and Historic Richmond by supporting the guidelines that you re-voted on in 2010. Thank you.
Thank you. If there's no further comment, I'll bring it back to the committee for discussion.
City Code Section 114.930.7b suggests that or says that features, designs, materials shall be preserved whenever possible. The only evidence we have here is that it was not really realistically possible to preserve these features. Okay? So we've taken care of that. Now, CAR may require repair instead of replacement. They don't have to. They have like these were an advisory, the old historic guidelines used in their documents with the application. These are advisory guidelines. They're not mandatory, they do not dictate what they do with their property. If you're an old historic property, this is the suggestion. There is a process we should follow. The homeowner was wrong to have not followed this process from the beginning. I think it's probably a question as to whether or not he knew he was in an old historic district. But regardless, he probably should have found out or hired a contractor who knew that they were in an old historic district. But this is advisory. It's not mandatory. And I think the message that we send here needs to be clear. We do not applaud not doing the right thing from the beginning, but we look at the totality of the circumstances to determine what the right course of action is. In this case, the right course of action is to overrule Paul. They clearly were in error on this case, that they do a lot that don't get appealed, and we have even sustained them on several appeals. It's not like we're sending a shot across their bow. We're mandated to make a decision based on the totality of the circumstances, and therefore I'm asking that they be forwarded to council with a recommendation for it.
Is there any other discussion?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'd like to move this paper forward with our and I'd also like to thank on that CAR. I know you do a good job. Sometimes that's a good
Is there a second? Yeah. We'll move that paper forward to the next calendar meeting. Item number 14, please, Mr. Clark.
Item number 14, resolution number 2013-R498, declare a public necessity to amend city code section 1. 14-402.2, and to amend